fly out be like, yeah, this is some racist stuff. She killed him because he was black. I feel like I can't say that.
No, nah, I can't say that either. Of course not. We can't say that. She nah. was afraid, though.
Yeah. And I feel like her reaction was real. Maybe it could still be put on, but for me, this is just negligence. She was being careless. And that says yep. more about the police system than it really does about racism. Because it's like, y'all let these people go in the street, but they don't have training. I feel like each police officer needs to have military training. You ever meet somebody in the military? Before they go in. Not before they're, you know, war shocked or anything like that.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
you ever meet somebody who had military training? Those people are, from my experience, are one of the most respected people.
They cross their T's and dot their I's.
Exactly. Now imagine if every single police officer and every police department across the U.S. were military men and women. They had military training. I'm not talking about the little boot camp that they do at police academy. I'm talking about everything that goes in to prepare men and women for war. To get that discipline, police officers need to have that. Because I'm not saying, like, sure, military men and women have issues. They will have psychological issues. They might even be racist. But mm-hmm. I have never met somebody in the military that I didn't respect on site.
Right.
Just, like, right. having a conversation with them. The way they speak. They warrant respect. They're very meticulous. Like you said, right. they cross their T's and they dot their I's. They're very Absolutely. Disciplined.
Absolutely.
You just, how long do you have to be in police academy before you can move on to?
6-8 months, something like that.
Are you sure?
6-8 months, something like that.
That's crazy. And what do they have to go through? Like,
they, I mean, to... they go, I can't tell you. I mean, I can't tell you what they go through, but, and I'm not going to say it's not enough. I don't, you want to know some? I'm not going to say that's besides the point either. Mm-hmm. However, you come in to the police force with the mindset anyway. Okay?
Okay.
You come in. People of European descent, black people, Hispanic people, you come into your career and your field of choice with your own misconceptions.
Right.
You understand? Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's the career's job to thrown these misconceptions. Okay. I say that to say, if you didn't have these misconceptions and the world wasn't so misconstrued and the world wasn't so neglectful and so demonic at times, it would limit the feasibility of you getting into an altercation and killing an unarmed guy. If right. I'm white and I come in and I don't, and if I come into the police force and I actually have respect for black people and I actually say to myself, you know what? Black people are just as honest as I am. Mm-hmm. They're just as hardworking and trustworthy as I am. I'm probably not going to have this type of altercation unless it's warranted.
Right.
However, if I come into this situation hating black people, saying the word nigga in my household, teaching my white daughters to stay away from black men because they all gonna rob and rape you. If I come into like that, I'm gonna be ready to body one of them once I get this position of power in my hand.
Right.
So I say that also to say it has something to do with how I come into the situation. Yeah, right. You can give me all type of training you want. You know what I'm saying? For real, for real. When I got my training as a counselor, my training actually did nothing for me because I was going on what I was placed in a situation. I came from an urban area. So I was placed in a situation where everybody I was counseling was from these urban areas.
Right.
So my urban background helped me become effective. My urban background helped my empathy I had for them because I know people like them. I was like them at one point. So that's what allowed me to have the empathy for them to become an effective counselor. If I don't come from that, but you put a white guy in that situation, he's not going to be effective. He can't understand what it is. Be broke and mommy can't feed you tonight. He don't understand what it is for you, you know what I mean? your teacher to, you know, say things about you, you know what I mean? And say, hey, why you talk that way? You know what I mean?
Right.
Things of that nature. He can't understand what you, he's going to have a discrepancy with the population. Same thing with these cops. It don't matter. The training is irrelevant, really. You know what I mean? Yeah, it helps a little bit. It helps a little bit. You good?
Yeah.
Oh, my fault. It helps a little bit. You know what I mean? But the training is really kind of irrelevant because if I come in there a racist, how you going to train me out of racism?
Right.
You can't train me out of racism. You understand? Mm. That's, racism is inherited. You don't wake up one morning at 25 years old and say, hey, you know what? Those black people I used to like yesterday and play basketball with, I don't like them anymore. Daddy taught you at 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old not to like those black people because they are untrustworthy. That's what he taught you. And our black parents, it's kind of sad to say, they taught us to respect white people. When I say respect them, now hold on, let me be a little ginger. They taught us how to
code switch.
Yeah, I'm trying to find the right word. They taught us how to give them some type of proper etiquette.
Okay.
Not the etiquette we get. They didn't, that's what I'm saying. They didn't teach us hate. They didn't teach us, yo, hate that white man. Our black parents don't teach us that. And I'm not saying they should or shouldn't, but they do not. Our black parents don't say, yo, hate that white man. You know why? Because 9 times out of 10, they think you're going to have to go through that white man to get what you want anyway. So yeah, code switch. You still got to go through them, right?
Yeah.
If I gotta switch my code, I still gotta put my real thoughts on the back burner. We get taught that.
How to maneuver, how to work in a white world.
That's the form of respect.
It is.
Why do I have to maneuver if I don't respect you? Think about it. Mm-hmm. If I don't respect you, I could do what the hell I want to do, right?
Yeah.
That's a form of respect for real. Like your kid that wants to do something but he know you don't want him to do it, he got to maneuver because he respects you because he know you might beat him down or tell him he got to stay in the crib for a month.
Right.
So he learns how to maneuver around that. Same thing with black people. We've been taught that we have to do this. And that's sad.
Mm-hmm.
That's sad that's even how we have to even raise our children and our men. That's the point I'm making. That's sad that I gotta learn how to, you know what I mean, talk in this white man's way, or I even dress in this white man's facet, or even respect his white woman to a certain, you know, manner. Because if I disrespect this white woman, all hell breaking loose.
Yep.
She's in position of power. The white woman is the most powerful woman in the world. Why? Because that white man gonna die, and that white woman is gonna inherit everything he has.
Mm-hmm.
She in position of power at the end of the day. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Woo! So, yo, man.
Final thoughts.
Any final thoughts on Dante Wright and his ill-advised set of circumstances, man?
Yeah.
That's the only way I can even put that out there.
Ill-advised. Like,
regular day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was the poor set of circumstances. I don't know, as much as I'm definitely pro-black, I don't know if this had anything to do with her being flat out racist, but it does play a part because she was scared because he was black. She pulled her taser because he was black. And so, you know, indirectly, she shot him because he was black. So, like, the protests that are happening right now, there's been violence and stuff like that. Y'all just need to chill out, because it's not, what's that do for you? Nothing. And I feel so bad for his mom, and he left a baby behind too. Like,
I see the little baby in the picture.
Yeah. Mm. So it's like, it is messed up. But we got, we're taking the wrong approach. I know when people are mad, they want to storm the streets, they want to protest, but you're not going to change anything. You're not going to accomplish anything with that. We saw that happen with the George Floyd protests. It was like, okay, so then they just threw a couple of cops that were dressed in civilian clothes and had them beat people up and loot stores and say it was us. Mm. Because we decided to go out and do that. Next thing you know, we're the people getting shot in the middle of a protest. And we're called rioters. You know what I mean? Like, it's a waste, man. It's a waste that but it's crazy coming from me, somebody who is usually so active and adamant about things like that. But it's like, yeah, I'm realizing now that we're taking the wrong approach. This kid shouldn't have died. He shouldn't. But he also shouldn't have tried to run away.
Right.
But that woman shouldn't have been scared. But it's just like instinct. Crazy. It was his instinct to run away. It was her instinct to pull the taser. Instinct. They're just moving. And the only way to stop instinct, the only way to think logically is to change your mindset. And that's the problem that we all have. And that is a major problem. I feel like the only way to fix that is through knowledge and information. And that's why that's why Juneteenth, y'all, Juneteenth, that Saturday, June 19th, from 1 p.m. Eastern to 4 p.m. Eastern, I'm hosting an event. It's called the Emancipation Movement, Rising Above the Shackles. We're going to have 8 speakers, 8 experts, and 8 aspects of Black life. And we're all going to get together and share that information. There will be prizes and giveaways for Black-owned businesses, so y'all know y'all won't be there. So stay tuned as we release more information.
That's right. That's right, man. It's going to be the bomb diggity. Now, I mean, not just because I'm going to be part of it, because Miss Portia Mystique is throwing it. That's why. You know what I mean? But, yo, man, final note. I want to give a big shout out to Hassan Campbell and his commentary about this situation with Dante Wright. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You know, I listened to his commentary and it sparked a lot of thought. You know what I mean? Which gave me the encouragement to do this podcast about that. So big up Hassan Campbell, you know what I'm saying? And RIP to Dante Wright. And I really believe that, you know, we gotta think differently. And another thing that Hassan Campbell said that really made me inspired, he said, what he always say, like, yo, we want to be outside and be active so bad that we're willing to put our lives on the line for it. Mm. And I'm not saying that that's what Dante Wright did. But during this pandemic, these last 13, 14 months has been the best time of my life, being with my family and getting into my mind and getting into my real skill set. It's been the best time of my life. And I think a lot of us need to learn how to stay still, man. You understand?
Yep,
you know, you've already told me, Portia, you know what I mean? You stays in the crib and you take care of business. It's safer there. Safer there.
It is.
And two, you can make your money from the crib. You don't have to go outside to make your money. I mean, that is if you're not a hands-on guy.
Yeah.
You
know what I mean? For me, the only time I was going out, like, okay, if I go jogging in the morning, but I'm sorry, right, I don't like jogging with a face mask. So we're gonna have to leave that alone. So I definitely put on my COVID-20, or whatever they're calling it. What they call it. 20 pounds you gained in COVID. Yeah, I put on my COVID-20, but I don't care. I still rather stay inside.
Well, that's what they said. They really said that?
Is it COVID-10 or COVID-20 or something like that?
I gained 25 pounds during COVID. maybe 20. I think I was 165. I'm 190. Like, serious. Crazy.
I think it's like, is it COVID-20? Because I gained just under 20 pounds.
Get out of here.
Wait, I wasn't going out before COVID anyway, so I don't know what my excuse is.
You know what? That's good living. And you're a very young woman. I'm quite sure that you can burn that off very quickly because of your age and your metabolism.
Right. I'm getting back to it. Now that school is back in session and, you know, James is busy all the time and everything's opening back up, so I could focus on that stuff. But I was definitely living that COVID life. Like, I was happy COVID at life. Home. My husband was home. Right. We was having a good time.
Chilling, man. Word up, man. So I say that to say, you know what? Think before you react, ladies and gentlemen. Please try to think before you react. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When you're dealing with these police officers, on the strength, abide by the law. Do you know what? For real, do what they say. I'm, you know, mm-hmm. if If I gotta do what, if you're in a position of power to kill me, I'm gonna do what you say.
Right.
And the person that say, no, I'm not, yeah, I ain't.
Yeah.
Gangsters die and go to jail.
Right.
Okay? So yeah. Do what they say and then keep it moving. And then when you're driving down a block, then curse them out. Okay? Mm-hmm. Perfect. Hey. So for Partial Mystique, your man Quan John, share, like, subscribe, y'all. Motivational Molders, baby. 100.